Pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight as we come before your presence. Impact our life with insight that lifts us to the place of achievement and accomplishment. All the obstacles on the way, knock them out and cause us to triumph in every way in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, because you've answered.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
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 Tonight, we are looking at the message. I believe that the outline is on the chat, so that if you want to download it, you can do so. We're looking at the message, Blueprint for Success and Greatness. Many people desire to succeed in life, but the more they chase after success, the farther the success seems to get away from them. Some people are making a lot of painstaking efforts, but their past is acting like a brake on their progress. We talked about this some time ago, that we need to remove those brakes. Other people are denied the ticket to greatness because they refuse to change. In fact, it has been said that life is not constant, that the only thing that is constant in life is change. You know, it's like a contradiction, that life is not constant, but the only thing that is constant in life is change. And when a person refuses to change, it's very bad. It has been said that those who refuse to change, they will always remain in chains. People that refuse to change mentally, they will remain in mental, you know, mental captivity. Those who refuse to change physically, they will remain in physical bondage. Those who refuse to change spiritually, they will be under the yoke of the enemy. Those who refuse to change will always remain in chains. So it's important. Some people are not succeeding because they refuse to change. I know we normally talk about insanity, but insanity has been defined as doing what you did yesterday that didn't bring you any success, doing the same today but expecting success. It doesn't work. That's insanity. If those things you did yesterday, none of it worked, and it's evident that they will never work, then you want to walk the same way today and yet experience success, it's insanity. For things to change, you must change your method. You must change your perspective. You must change your priority. You must change your outlook. You must change the way you walk. That's the way things eventually you will succeed. So some people are denied the ticket to greatness because they refuse to change. The refusal to change keeps them in chains. The past, our past is important, but you need to manage that past very well, because your past can be a hindering burden that you carry, or it may be a valuable mine that you quarry. You see the two things, carry and quarry. If your past is like a burdensome, it's a hindering burden, you carry it like a heavy load, like a heavy yoke, it will hinder you. You will not move forward. But if your past is like a mine where you go to quarry, quarry for precious stones, quarry for things that are useful, you quarry for wisdom, for effective living in the past, in the present, you can get insight from the past to live effectively in the present. The blueprint for success and greatness has some important pillars that support it, and we are looking at a few tonight. Tonight, I'm looking at four major things. Number one, forgiveness. That's the Lord's priority. Number two, forgetting the past that has been limiting you. Number three, focusing on your limitless potential. And number four, manifesting faith for lasting progress. Number one, forgiveness. This is the Lord's priority. We can never build a great life on a rotten foundation. Great edifices require strong and stable foundations. Somebody wants to build a bungalow, you need a simple foundation. But if you want to build a 30-story building, you need a bigger, stronger foundation that is going to go deeper, more steel, more concrete, because you are supporting an infrastructure that is going to go to 30 levels. Wind and all the elements of weather are going to beat upon it, and you want it to stand. So your foundation depends on your goal. It depends on where you want to be. If somebody wants to build a bungalow, a simple foundation is sufficient. You will build it and you will live inside it. But you want to build a skyscraper, the foundation for the bungalow is good enough, but it's not good enough. It's good enough for the bungalow, but it's not good enough for the skyscraper. So you can't be looking at, okay, this is the foundation I'm going to erect because this is the foundation that my friend erected. No, what's your goal? Are you building a bungalow? Are you building a skyscraper? That will determine the kind of foundation that you build. But no matter the foundation that you build, forgiveness is the cornerstone. And the Bible says that if the foundations, Psalm 11 verse 3, why are foundations very important? Because if the foundation be destroyed, every other thing falls. Psalm 11 verse 3, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? That question is not answered in the Bible, but the question is obvious. There is nothing the righteous can do. If the foundation is destroyed, you need to pull down the entire structure and start all over because it will not support the infrastructure. So if the foundations are destroyed or the foundations are faulty, there is not much that anybody can do. And that's why the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then every other thing, including success, including greatness, shall be added unto you. So forgiveness is the Lord's priority and is the basic and the most important foundation, you know, the forerunner of greatness. Forgiveness in Christ, forgiveness by the blood of Jesus, is the surest foundation for a successful life. If we want to succeed, this is the thing. Forgiveness is God's priority if we ever hope to achieve success. And you know what I want to say? Many times when we talk about forgiveness, many people look at forgiveness on one level. No. I want to show you forgiveness on three levels, and they are all important. If you want to get to the place of success and greatness, forgiveness on three levels. Number one, forgiveness on the vertical level. That's you and God looking up. Forgiveness from God for the sins we have committed, our past sins. Forgiveness from God from the kind of life we have lived before in disobedience. You know, the Bible says we are, you know, living in the lust of the flesh and in the, you know, living with a rebellious mind. We repent, then God forgives us, cleanses us, and makes us children of God. But we also need to forgive those who have sinned against us. You know what Jesus said? If you do not forgive men their trespasses against you, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses against him. The forgiveness that you give to others conditions the forgiveness that God gives unto you. That's the Lord's Prayer. And many times, people only think about forgiveness from God. You also need to give forgiveness. There are people that have wronged you. There are people that have sinned against you. There are people that have hurt you. There are people that have sabotaged you. There are people that have spoken bad things against you. There are people that have maltreated you. There are people that have maligned and blackmailed you. You need to forgive. You can't carry on in unforgiveness. It will eat you up. It will drain your energy, spiritual energy, physical energy. Unforgiveness will eat you up like cancer. And instead of being able to have the energy to pursue greatness, that energy will be eaten up and drained by unforgiveness every time. You need to release yourself. That's important. Forgive. I've told you over and over, if you look at people that have been maltreated, people that their lives, I mean, a major part of their lives have been wasted in prison. You know the way they survived when they came out of prison? By forgiving. Because they said, if I bottle that anger, even now that I'm outside, I will still be in chains. There is no difference between that cell and when I'm outside. If I don't forgive, that unforgiveness will still hold me in chains and in bitterness. We need to forgive. I don't know who has done anything to you, who has spoken things about you, who have maybe maligned you and maltreated you. They've blackmailed you. They told lies against you, things you didn't do. It may be in secondary school. It may be now. It may be at any time. You need to forgive. Release yourself. These are going to be breaks. Release yourself. And number three, forgive yourself for your past mistakes. You know, some people have not forgiven themselves. And that is a major destroyer. Many, many times. Major destroyer. When you don't forgive yourself for the past mistakes that you did, you don't forgive yourself for foolish actions you took in the past, you don't forgive yourself for refusing to heed good advice in the past, you don't forgive yourself for playing instead of walking. You know, some students have failed because they played. They didn't walk. And now there is new opportunity to rise up and eventually do another course. And he says, you know, if I was serious in secondary school, I shouldn't be here. I should have been further up. But you are not serious in secondary school. That past has gone. New opportunity has come. Forget about that past. Forgive yourself. Rise up and take advantage of the new opportunity today. Some people are held by the past. You find a woman that possibly has messed up a lot from boyfriend to boyfriend, from man to man, from bed to bed, when she was an unbeliever, young, wasted her life. Okay, now she gets born again, she becomes a child of God. Do you know that if that kind of woman does not forgive herself, it may be very difficult to get married? Every time she just saying, God, I'm not good enough for anybody. Look at how I lived in the past, like a dog. And she will be denigrating herself. To get married is going to be difficult. Most of people like that, they remain single for life because they think that they are not good enough for anybody. They've wasted too much of their life that it will be bad for God to give them to anybody. That woman will remain unmarried, I'm telling you. And the reason is she's not forgiven herself. If you knew better, you wouldn't have done that. You've done it. We can't reverse the clock. We cannot rewrite history. History is already there. That's how you lived, but we can move into the future. And this is important. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sorry, the internet just went all of a sudden. Okay, so that kind of a woman may never be married because she's always denigrating herself. Do you realize that that's what could have happened to Rahab? When Rahab looks at herself that she was the, you know, prostitute, public prostitute in Jericho, after God saved her, do you see that God gave Rahab, the husband that God gave Rahab, is one of the best men in Israel, Boaz. Go and read the book of Ruth. You see the quality of Boaz for a person like, that's Ruth. Now, what I'm talking about is Rahab. Rahab eventually married in Israel. Rahab became one of the ancestors of Jesus Christ. What do you think that God is thinking about for God to allow Rahab to be part of the lineage that brought Jesus to the world. When God cleanses your past, you are cleansed. Whatever you have done, you need to rise beyond that and forgive yourself. You need to say, God, I thank you, because even a person like me that could have perished with all what I did, you showed mercy on me and you redeemed me. Forgive yourself. Many of us have not forgiven ourselves. And that is like a break holding you up. Guilt every single time. You are not able to move forward. The guilt weighs you down. The remembrances of the way you lived in the past is holding you back. So that's another level of forgiveness that many people do not know about. They don't know how to forgive themselves for their past mistakes. They don't know how to forgive themselves for the foolish actions they've taken in the past. They don't know how to forgive themselves for refusing to heed good advice. People gave you good advice before, but you neglected it. You said, no, this one don't know. Until when you have failed miserably and things have gone by, say, how could I be so stupid? And they gave me this advice. They told me, how was I deaf? But it's gone. That opportunity is gone. Clean up, rise up, face the new day. Because you cannot roll the hand of the clock back. That's another level of forgiveness. Forgive yourself. If you are a student, you have played before, you failed. Now, there's a new opportunity for you to rise, new opportunity for you to study and to move on. Well, years have been wasted. You cannot recover those years. But the future brings new possibilities. You need to rise. So forgiveness on three levels. Number one, forgiveness from God. Number two, forgive those who have hurt you, those who have spoken ill against you, those who have maltreated you, those who have persecuted you, those who have done things that can easily make you to be bitter against them. Forgive them. Then number three, you need to forgive yourself. Otherwise, it's going to be difficult for you to move. You know what it's going to be? Unforgiveness is going to be like a friction. When you don't forgive yourself, you know, if you are riding a bicycle that is brand new, you don't even hear the noise. You just be going and you'll be moving. When you are riding a bicycle that the chains have rusted, as you are riding, you are hearing, you are putting a lot of energy, but a lot of that effort is destroyed in the friction. You'll be putting a lot of energy, but the bicycle is not moving. You know why? The effort is destroyed in the rusted chains. The friction. You are putting effort, yes, but there's so much friction. You are not moving. And that's what will happen. Unforgiveness will be like that. You'll be putting so much effort, but you can't see any progress because those things are destroyed. The energy is sapped by those kind of things. And you need every one of us, you need to get to that level. You know, I've gotten to that level by the grace of God over many years. I don't remember the past, no matter what it was. The past is gone. My future is more important. What God is doing today is more important. What God has in store for me for the next few years is more important. And I focus on that. And that's it. Your past has been forgiven by God. Forgive yourself. It's not God, it's yourself. Think about people that have been herbalists, for example. Many people have come to them, help me to do juju to kill this one, do juju, kill that one. Help me to do juju to kill this one, do juju, kill that one. Help me to do juju to paralyze this one, we'll do that. If you think about the many lives that individual has destroyed, so many, on behalf of other people, but also there might be other things that he has done. When that individual now gets saved, if he does not forgive himself, he cannot enjoy his salvation. The guilt will be coming back every time. The many lives he has wasted. That's why this touch point is very, very important. Look at yourself. What are those things that still bring that God has forgiven? God has forgiven you. But every time you remember it, it brings guilt to your heart. It holds you back. It brings memories that are very toxic, back into your life. Those are things that is telling you in those areas of your life, you have not forgiven yourself. And it's going to be a problem. Moving forward is going to be a problem. You know, sometimes some people get married. And unfortunately, for one reason or the other, maybe one partner goes to mess up. We should not be. Unfaithfulness in marriage should not be. If you are not careful, even after God has forgiven your partner, and you also say you are forgiven your partner, that marriage may never be what it ought to be. Every time you come back and you remember that unfaithfulness, and it holds you back. You want to help your partner to be maybe his best or her best, but you remember that she's not worth it. Look at what she did. I got married to her. She went and messed up. Or maybe the woman, look at what he did. With all the commitment that I gave to him, look at what he went to do. It's not, that family will never move forward. So I'm not justifying sin. You need to understand. And I'm not saying that sin is right in any way. No. But when we come to the cross and we repent and God forgives us, we need to come to the point where we also can forgive ourselves, leave it behind, and run the race, run ahead. If you don't do that, you are going to carry a burden all your life. It will serve like a weight, hindering you to run. You know, it's like somebody trying to run 100 meters and the person is carrying weight. How much can you run? Other people will finish that 100 meters in 12 seconds. If you finish in 60 seconds, you have tried. Because the weight just weighs you down. Every step is a burden. That's what will happen. So forgiveness on three levels. Forgiveness from God. You need to forgive those who have offended you. And lastly, you need to forgive yourself. In Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13, this is the divine promise. Proverbs 28, verse 13. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. We have the promise of forgiveness from the Lord, and it's foundational, and it's important, and it's the Lord's priority. Seeking first the kingdom of God is the first thing that God wants us to do to come out of sin. Say, if you are willing and you are obedient, you will eat the good of the land. He has promised us great things if we repent. Number two, forgetting the limiting past. Let's assume that you have repented. God has forgiven you. You've forgiven all the people that did all kinds of atrocities against you. You have forgiven yourself. Say, now, this is a brand new me. Before, you were Mary Magdalene with seven evil spirits. But now, this is a brand new Mary Magdalene without any evil spirit, but with the Holy Ghost. You've been in Rahab before, and then you say, well, thank God we have left behind immorality and prostitution in Jericho. This is a brand new Rahab looking for a better life. Maybe you have been in Zacchaeus. Say, well, before, my life has been a life of crime and cheating other people and exploiting and extorting money from people. But now, this is a brand new Zacchaeus. We are going forward. That's what needs to happen. As God forgives you, forgive other people and forgive yourself. Then, forget the limiting past. Many people are not traveling fast towards life as achievement because their past is acting like a brake on their progress. If you are traveling in a car, no matter how much you accelerate, if the brake is on, that car will not move. You can burn all the fuel. You can accelerate as much as you want. But as long as the brake is on, it will slow down that car. You are not going to move. And the same way in life, many of us are traveling. But we are not able to travel fast because our past is acting like a brake on our progress. There are many people, they are laden with burdensome emotions. And what are those burdensome emotions? Anger, regret, guilt, resentment. These are negative emotions that drain energy, that just changes your mood. You are never optimistic about life. You always see the dark side of life. In fact, you hate being alive today. That's what they will do to you. You never see the bright side of life. You need to drop these burdensome emotions. Some other people, they have some painful memories. Maybe especially women. Men have jilted you in the past. Well, leave those men. They are rascals. There are better men waiting for you. Some people have disappointed you. There are opportunities you have missed. You've been rejected one time or the other. You have been sexually abused. You have been physically abused, physical assault. You have been verbally abused. And those memories, they are painful. Every time they come, like sharp pain in the heart, racking pain in the head. And if you are not careful, you want to find a way to revenge. You need to drop those painful memories, burdensome emotions, painful memories. They are going to sound like break. What do you think that Joseph should have done? His brothers sold him to Egypt. What do you think that Joseph should have done? Potiphar's wife told lies against him. He went into prison. If it is some of us, when we became prime minister, I say, now, I will show Potiphar's wife who I am. My brother, forget. Let Potiphar's wife go. Let her go away. Just forgive her. There is no point. Those are burdensome emotions. It will put you in captivity. It will put you in chains. It will retard your progress. It will hinder your move. Leave them alone. Burdensome emotions. Oh, Joseph suffered so much. Remember, his brother sold him. Potiphar's wife told lies against him. The person he interpreted dream for, I said, when you get out of this prison, please remember me and tell my case to Pharaoh. That one forgot him for 2 years. It was only when Pharaoh dreamt a dream and nobody could interpret. I remember. I also dreamt a dream like this 2 years ago when I was in prison. Somebody interpreted it. It's not that he remembered by himself. It was an event that triggered it. What do you think that Joseph should have thought about? I did this man good, but look at, he forgot me. Oh, many times there are disappointments in life. Many times there are people that will do all these kind of things, but you need to leave them. If you don't leave them, you're not going to. You know what the Bible says? When my father and my mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Even if your parents have abandoned you, thank God there is a God in heaven, a father of the fatherless. He will help you. He will make a way for you in the wilderness. He will create rivers for you in the desert. He will lead you to your destiny. He's the one that created you. Don't be bitter against them. That's important. Very, very important. So we need to drop these burdensome emotions and painful memories. Forget, because they will limit you in the present. They will limit your potential. They will limit your achievement. They will hinder you from getting to the place of accomplishment. You need to drop them. You know, when I was growing up, my mom told me a story. And it was the story, you could see that she was holding resentment. Because my mom said, when I was about 1 year old, in the compound, that there was a big snake that was going in the compound. And being a child, I didn't know anything. That I crawled, I was crawling, you know, trying to get to the snake, to take the snake. And my mom said there was a woman that was watching and she was laughing and she was very happy. Eventually, anyway, Nothing happened. The snake was able to escape and went. And my mom looked at the woman and said, you are a wicked woman. A 1-year-old is crawling, going to take that snake. You can't rescue that child. And what you are doing is, you want to see how the child will take the snake and the snake will bite, and you are laughing. And my mom is telling me this story when I'm already about 20 years old. And I told my mom, but I'm still here. God helped me. God saved me. God protected me. Forget about it. My mom wanted to mention the name of Duma. I said, I'm not interested. I don't even want to know her. I don't want to hold her in my heart. So don't even tell anything about her anymore. The story you have told is sufficient. I don't want to know the person. I don't want to know the name. I don't want to hold any grudge against anybody. The event didn't happen. God has forgiven me. I told my mom, forget. Completely forget. Otherwise, all those things are going to hold you back. They will hold you back. And many of us have those kind of painful memories. We have those kind of bothersome emotions, and they are serving like brake. And every day, traveling the journey of life is heavy for you because the brake is on. Release the brake. Forget the limiting past. Very, very important. The bothersome car past can hinder. You know, when Jacob died, the brothers of Joseph, they came to Joseph. Their father didn't say so, but they formulated it. They said, before our father died, he said we should tell you that you should forgive us for what we did for you. Joseph just looked at them and said, don't worry. You meant it for evil, but look at how God has turned it to my good. I don't hold it against you. I will feed you. I will help you. That's somebody that has forgiven from their heart. Amen.
Amen.
And he prospered as a result. He was not hooked. He was not in bondage. He was not in chains. He said, you meant it for evil, but at the end of the day, God turned it for my glory. God turned it to my good. We thank God for that. But don't worry. That one doesn't matter. I will feed you. Feed your needy little ones. I will help you. That's how we ought to be. You know, I remember a particular brother. That brother, because they didn't have a child at that time, he was sponsoring the children in the family. And do you know what? The family didn't want this brother to have a child because they said, once he has a child of his own, the money we are getting to train our own children we will not get. Do you see how wicked the family is? Today that brother has a child. But I told him, brother, you forgive them. God will help you. You will have a child. But still help them the way you can. How can you say because you are getting a lot of money, is educating your child in the university, that one in the secondary school, and you don't, and you know that they've been married more than 10 years, no issue, but nobody in the family, they don't even want them to, they don't want that couple to have an issue because they say, once they have an issue, all this money we are getting, we will not get. How can somebody think like that? And the brother was almost bitter. He came to me and I had to counsel him. I said, don't worry. There was another brother that came and then said, you, everybody is going to Europe. Even this one also is going to Europe. And when they say it, it's like your coming to Europe is a mistake. I told the brother, don't worry. God will help you. You will succeed in Europe. And when you have succeeded, they will come begging to help them, still help them. Because they don't want you to succeed, but when you have succeeded, they are still in poverty. They still need your help. They will come back in, but at that time, don't retaliate. Still help them. That's what we are talking. That's the way to be in life. Let your heart be so big so that God can open pathways for you. Be a Joseph. Potiphar's wife has done you a great harm. wasted your life in prison for what you didn't do. When you get to the place of opportunity and you could retaliate, don't retaliate. Leave her alone. Your brothers have sold you to Egypt. Now you get into a place where now they are suffering in famine. And you could have said, now, you sold me to Egypt. Now you suffer for your famine. No, rise up and still be a help. Forgive. Forgive. Let your heart be free. That's the way to the top. Oh. That's the way to greatness. That's the way to success. Every unforgiveness you hold in your heart is going to hinder you. It will sound like a break in your life. It doesn't help you. So it's important. Let's drop these burdens. The burdensome past can hinder your ability to live effectively in the present. You need to forget this limiting past. You need to drop the hindering burdens and fight for your life. Pursue your vision. Go after your life goals and live your dreams. Don't let these emotions eat up your energy. Don't let them occupy your thinking time. You'll be thinking, why did this person even do this in the first place? And for the next 30 minutes, you are trying to unravel the reason why I did it for you. Wasted time, wasted 30 minutes. When that 30 minutes, you could have used it to think about how to move forward in your next project. How are you going to take that? God is calling you and telling you tonight that you need to drop those kind of burdens, burdensome emotions, drop them. Painful memories, drop them. Whatever anybody has done, they don't really matter. Move on, because they will not help you. Like Jephthah. Remember what they did to Jephthah. Look at Judges chapter 11. You know what they did to Jephthah? It's his half-brothers. Jephthah was not responsible for his life now, for his birth. Somebody gave birth to him. He had no choice in that. Unfortunately, he was born out of wedlock. Judges chapter 11, verse 1. Now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor, and he was the son of an allot, and Gilead begat Jephthah. And Gilead's wife bare him sons, and his wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah, and said unto him, thou shalt not inherit in our father's house, for thou art the son of a strange woman. Then Jephthah fled from his brethren and dwelt in the land of Tob. And there were gathered vain men to Jephthah and went out with him. Other boys that had been driven out, like Jephthah was driven out, they now became street boys. Street boys in Tob. But do you know that that same Jephthah that was rejected eventually became the president of the nation? And don't you understand that the stone which the builders rejected, the same is become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our sight. That's what they did to Jephthah. Rejection, ejection from his father's house. He had the father's house, but could not live in. He could not enjoy the comfort of home. He had to live in the streets. What is he going to do? He needed to forget the past. Otherwise, he will not move on in life. The bitterness will eat him up. He will become, you know, that's what happens to people. Then they turn into crime. But the crime is going to destroy them. Like Jephthah, we need to drop the rejection. And we need to overcome life's inevitable blows. Jephthah rose up and overcame. And the started developing himself. He became a leader over all those other boys. And started developing them. And they became mighty in the art of war. When Israel ran into an emergency and there was nobody to lead them to war, they've been watching Jephthah and they said, these guys, these boys, they are tough. They know what they are doing. Let's go for their services. And they came to Jephthah and they said, Jephthah, come home and help us. And Jephthah said, me, come home and help you. You elders of Israel, you join together with my father's house and you drove me out. Now that you are in crisis, now you are coming. Say, we didn't know it would turn out like this. We are very sorry. We didn't know eventually that this is where God will place you. A man of importance, a man with a lot of skill. We are very sorry. We didn't know. Just forgive us. If you come home with us and you come to lead the battle and we win the victory, we will make you our president. Jephthah said, do you mean it? They said, and that's what they did. And that's how Jephthah became a judge. You need to drop the rejection. You need to drop the burdens. You need to overcome life's inevitable blows. They come to all of us from time to time. There are uncles that could have helped you. They were very rich. The money they will pay for your school fees is almost nothing. But they refused. But you are still where you are today, even without their help. Forgive. God has helped you. God brought other helpers to your life. God helped you despite people that could have helped you, and they have the capacity. And it wouldn't have mean anything to them, but they just refused. Because they wanted to be the only tree in the forest. And you know what they say? One tree cannot make a forest. One tree remains a single tree. But they want to be the only tree in the forest. What kind of forest is that? But God still helped you anyway. Forgive. Forget. Drop those limiting past. Like Rahab. If Rahab was to be thinking about her shady past, her past of prostitution in Jericho, she would never have gotten married. She would never have thought, I'm not good enough for any man. She would never have gotten married. Then look at her, I've wasted my life in prostitution, day in, day out, morning till evening, for so many years. She would never have gotten married. But she forgot the shady past of life in Jericho. And it got on with the business of life. Now that she is in Israel, God has rescued her. God has saved her. A new life begins. You know, in Jericho, she was not married. Prostitutes don't marry. And yet, when God saved her, she came into Israel. Now she settled down. Family life. A new life. She found an husband. That's what we're talking about. Forget the limiting past. If God has forgiven you, forgive yourself and move on. Forgive yourself and move on. Very important. You know, sometimes on a platform like this, after I finish the message, somebody will phone me and say, Pastor, I wished I had this message 20 years ago. Unfortunately, you didn't hear the message 20 years ago. You are hearing it now. What do you expect Abraham to do? By the time Abraham was hearing the real message, he was 75. Regret is not going to do you any good. You better make the best use of the rest of your life. That was what Abraham did. How are we going to be regretting that we have wasted our youth? Abraham would have said, I'm 75. Why is this message coming now that I'm 75? This message should have come when I was 25. I would still have had another 50 years. Now I'm 75. Unfortunately, the message is coming to you. You are 75. But maybe you are going to live another 10 years. Make those 10 years the best of your life. That's what is important. So like Abraham, we have to forget about wasted youth and make the rest of our life the very best. No matter your situation, you know, there is nobody that doesn't have something to regret in life. There is nobody. But regret is a waste of time. It doesn't do anything. It's a waste of mental resources. You need to forgive yourself when God has forgiven you, and you need to move on. Every single time God has called you and you are 50, make the best of your life, the rest that remains. God has called you and somebody is 65, make the best of your life. That's what matters. Unfortunately, you didn't hear the message when you were 20. So people are hearing these messages now, and they wonder and say, if I had this message before I went into the university, I would have made a first class. Unfortunately, you didn't hear the kind of message like this. You went to university, you have come out, and now you are doing your master's. Use the message to be your best in your master's. The past is gone. There is nothing you can do about it. But the future is open for new possibilities. Don't play the regret game every time. No, move on. And I pray that tonight we will move on in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So you need to forget the limiting past. You know why? The limiting and the burdensome past as a way, number one, of anchoring you to the shoreline of failure and mediocrity. If you are always remembering your past, you will never move on. It will lock you down to the shorelines of failure, lock you down to the shorelines of mediocrity. Excellence will never characterize your life. It's impossible. Number two, when you are always, dwelling on the past, it will reduce you to a worthless zero when you could have imagined a celebrated hero. That's what it will do. Every time you see your unworthiness, every time you see why even God should not have had mercy on a person like you, you denigrate yourself every time. Instead of rising up to be a hero, sometimes I tell some of our brethren in Italy, some brethren will say, oh, Pastor, look at me now. How can I look at me? I don't have documents. I don't know what I'm going to do. And then I said, do you realize that Joseph had no visa to get to Egypt? He was smuggled into Egypt. He was sold as a slave to Egypt. But in Egypt, he became a hero. In Egypt, he became the prime minister. And I tell them, my brother, it doesn't matter. You have come through the desert. You have come through the sea. Now you are in Europe. Believe God. You've come like a zero, but believe God to make you a hero. Forget the past and move on. You know, there's a particular Nigerian in Ireland. Presently, he's the mayor. He got to Ireland, he was a refugee. But now he's the mayor of the city. Very, very important. Forget the past. Concentrate on the future, where you are going. Don't let the past reduce you to a worthless zero. Focus on being a celebrated hero. You came to Europe a refugee. You must rise up to be a celebrated prince. And I pray the Lord himself will do it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Dwelling on your past will hold you back from going after your dreams. Dwelling on the past will prevent you from pursuing your vision. Dwelling on the past will rob you of the possibility of greatness. Dwelling on your past will hold you in chains and in pains. Forget the limiting past. You need to forget it. No matter how painful, you need to forget it. Look at in Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. How do you think that Paul the apostle could have been the kind of apostle that he was? Did you see how he persecuted the church? Did you see how many Christians he imprisoned? He had to forgive himself. Otherwise, he could not have been the greatest apostle of the church. The same church that he was wrecking in havoc. But God now called him and made him an apostle. If he didn't forgive himself, you remember that he was the gang leader when Stephen was stoned to death. How could he have executed his ministry as an apostle? He wouldn't. The guilt of the death of Stephen, the guilt of many people that he imprisoned, the guilt of many people that he was the mastermind behind their deaths and their fiery persecution, it would dog him for life. But Paul was smarter than that. He forgave himself. He rose up and became a great apostle of the church. Philippians chapter 3, in verse 13, the Bible says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. You see the two things that Paul said he was doing, forgetting the past, reaching forth and focusing on the future. Verse 14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Pressing toward the mark. You forget the past, reach forth, you know, into the future. That's what Paul did. If he didn't do that, he couldn't have executed his ministry as an apostle. He wouldn't have been able to write out of 27 books in the New Testament. Paul wrote 14. That's more than half. How could he have been able to do that with all the atrocities he did in the past? You need to forget that past. When God forgives you, you forget that past. Otherwise, that past will limit you in the present. It will not allow you to be your very best. You need to understand, this is what God is telling us tonight. I don't care what your past is all about. It doesn't matter. The future is more important. God wants to raise you to a new level of effectiveness, new level of success, new level of greatness. But you need to forget that limiting past. You need to drop those hindering burdens. You need to drop those painful memories. You need to drop all those things that when they come over you, sometimes, you know, emotions of anger and bitterness will come because of what people, sometimes it's just what people said. It's just what people said. You know Malcolm X? Malcolm X was a very, very brilliant student and he wanted to be a lawyer. But you know, one of his teachers looked at him and said, a nigger like you should not be a lawyer. It's not worth being a lawyer. And do you know that that thing pained Malcolm X? Instead of pursuing being a lawyer, that's how Malcolm X turned into crime. And eventually he was sentenced to 10 years in prison for the crimes he committed. Eventually he served 7 years in prison and then they released him. By that time, he's already been thinking and go. And eventually he came out, you know, to join the civil rights movement and do things like that. People can say things, but don't waste your life because of people's comments. Don't waste your life because of people's comments. Whatever people want to say, you want to be what God wants you to be. Leave their comments. You know, I told people there was a time that, I've never seen my mom being sad. My mom is always very ebullient, but this day, she looked very depressed. So I asked her, what is troubling you? She said nothing. I said, no. This is not you. Even your face reveals that something is wrong. And I told her, I'm your first son. I want to know. Tell me. Maybe I might be able to help you. Eventually, after a lot of persuasion, my mom now asked me and said, do you know so-and-so? I said, yes. She said, you know so-and-so just looked at me in my face and said, you and your children, a generation of paupers. And it was like a sharp arrow that went into my mom's heart. I said, how can somebody say that? Because we are struggling. If you see the space where we were living in Ibadan at that time, very small, 8 of us children, my mom and my dad, myself alone cannot live in that space today if I want to live alone. It's too small. But 10 of us were crowded like sardines in that place. And many times even there's no money to pay the rent. The place had no window. If thieves come, thieves just come in. Because the wall had no window. Thief can easily just come in. We lived like that. That was what we could afford. And somebody now said that you and your children. I told my mom, don't worry. It's their words. I told my mom, they are words. Leave them. You know, today, the same person that said that, you can feed him and feed him for life. That's God. I told my mom, forget, it's just words. How are you going to keep that in your mind? Forget. If the person doesn't have sense enough, cannot help you, and the only thing he can do is to still abuse you with those kind of sharp words, then that person is not worth, just forget, just leave it. And that's what I told my mom. Very, very important. Forget the limiting past. What people have said to you, the abuse that people have done, have spoken unto you, blackmail, and lies they have said against you, forget. Because if you don't forget, you are wasting your potential. Those things will hold you in the shoreline of failure and mediocrity. Those things will put a brake on your life. Those things will make you not to get to where God has destined you to get to. They will hold you back. Forget the limiting past. We cannot deny the past. It's our past. You can't dissociate yourself from the past, but you can learn lessons from the past and move on. That's the usefulness of the past. You can learn lessons from it and move on. Your future is more important than your past. Although your future is rooted in your past, because where you are today is as a result of how you have lived your life in the past. So your present is rooted in the past. But your present can now take off in another direction, irrespective of how the past has been. And that's important. So you need to forget the limiting past. Learn the lessons from them, the things you have done, foolish actions you have taken in time past that didn't profit you. Learn not to do that again. You do things in a different way. You didn't listen to counseling in time past and it has not profited you. Now you listen to good counsel. You have a mentor. You have somebody that can analyze things for you and say, well, you are thinking this way, but this should be. You know, present recently, about 2 weeks ago, somebody came to see me. And the person said, I would like to move to Germany. And by the time we finished discussion, the person said, Pastor, thank you for your counsel. I'm no longer moving to Germany. Because I just told this individual, you want to move to Germany, but you have already spent about 11 years in Italy. Why don't you process your citizenship? This and this and that and that. You're going to go and start in Germany all over, and then you forfeit this. Why don't you? The person never saw it that way. Counseling. And then he said, Pastor, I didn't see it that way, this and that and that. And right there and then, he just canceled all that plan and said, now I'm going back to go and implement what you said and go and go. Listen to good counseling that will help you. Very, very important. And if we do that, it means we are learning from the past. Because in the past, people have given us good counseling, we didn't heed, and it backfired. So that's learning from the past. The mistakes of the past, don't repeat them. Learn from the fact that I didn't listen to advice, I landed in the fire. Now, I should listen to good advice from good mentors, from good role models that will help me. Very, very important. That's what the past is all about. Mine gold from your past. But don't be limited by that past. Number three, we need to focus on our limitless potential. Paul said, forgetting the things that are past, I reach forth unto those things which are before. Let that be your motto. Forget the things that are past. Reach forth unto those things which are before. Reach, you know, travel towards the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let your trust be forward motion. Let your vision be always looking forward. You cannot drive forward by looking in the rear mirror. No. Nobody drives forward by looking in the rear mirror. You drive forward by looking forward. Very, very important. The past may be a story told. Your future can yet be written in gold. Rather than be preoccupied with the burdens of the past, we can focus on the blessings of the present. It is not sufficient to forget the limiting past. We must reach forth unto those things that are before. It's two things. If tonight you get the message and you don't say, Pastor said we should forget the limiting past, that doesn't bring you success. Because it's not sufficient. You must do the two. Forget the limiting past, but reach forth unto your potential, unto the future, unto the best. Pursue your destiny with all the force, with all the skills, with all the energy, with all the endowment that God has given you. Forget the past, but reach unto the future. So it is not sufficient to forget the limiting past. We must reach forth unto those things that are before. We need to press towards the mark of God's high calling in Christ Jesus. Rather than living in bitterness and self-pity because of rejection, Jephthah concentrated on developing himself. Occupy yourself with something useful. Occupy your time. Instead of thinking about why did they do this, why did they do this, occupy that same time to think, what can I do? How can I move forward? That's a better use of your time. Don't use your time to be analyzing why the enemy did what he did. Use that time to analyze how you will get to where you ought to get to. Utilize your time in a better way. Don't be locked, you know, in those kind of, in those kind of network. Rather than regretting his wasted youth, Abraham concentrated on making the rest of his life the best. Do you know when we read the story of Abraham today? Many people forget that Abraham started when he was 75. Most of us, many people don't remember. Abraham started the Christian, so-called, the journey with God when he was 75. At that time, many people are thinking about retirement, but that was when he started. People that are 75 years old, they are looking more for security. But God told Abraham, leave the off the Chaldees, launch into the unknown. People that are 75 generally don't take risks because they think that, well, I've come to the end of life, I will soon be gone. So why take risk? But that's the time that Abraham started taking risk, leaving the unknown to go for the, leaving the known to go for the unknown, leaving the familiar to go for the unfamiliar, risking everything in life at 75. That's when he started. Whatever age that God has called you, that's the age. Then rise up and spend the rest of your life and do something. You know, many people never knew that by the time Nelson Mandela came out of prison, he was 69. He went to prison when he was 42. He spent 27 years on Robben Island in the prison in, you know, in South Africa. By the time he came out, he was 69, going 70. And people thought he just came out, he will soon die. But do you realize that Nelson Mandela still lived another 25 years? He died when he was 95. And he, what he did in those 25 years for South Africa is amazing. He could have, you know, he could have been bodily bitterness from that people wasted 27 years of his life unnecessarily in prison, and he would never have been anything. The remaining 25 years of his life would have been wasted as well. Coming out of prison at 70, but the next 25 years, he was still able to make an impact on his nation in South Africa. That's how I want you to be thinking, my brothers. That's how I want you to be thinking, my sisters. It's not the time God calls you. God called Abraham at 75, but Abraham made an impact with the remaining of his life. Don't think about, no, don't regret the wasted youth. Don't regret the wasted time. The harvest has, the summer has come, the harvest has ended, and we are not saved. Well, that one is gone. New opportunity has come. Arise and pursue it. That's important. You know, lesser men would have just given up. What can I do? 70. Nothing. And they would just go to their house and rest like that until they die. But Nelson Mandela said, even though I'm 70, the prime of my life has gone, 27 years wasted in prison, but I can still do something. And he rose up and did something. And in the next 25 years, he still left an impact on South Africa. I pray that you will leave an impact in your generation.
Amen.
I said, I pray you will leave an impact in your generation.
Amen.
Don't let regret take over your life. Don't let, you know, whatever has happened in the past be a hindrance unto you. Don't let it be a break upon your life. It may be your age. It may be your profession. You know, there are people, I was reading a particular individual. He wanted to be an economist. But unfortunately, he couldn't get He couldn't get admission to read economics. And then he got admission to go and read library studies. Do you know what? Eventually, he didn't regret it. He made a valuable, tremendous contribution to that field. Eventually, he was noted. You know, some other people say, well, if actually I had my way, I wanted to be an economist, not this librarianship. And that's what they are going to talk about all life. And it's every time, if I had had my way, I would have been an economist today. But you are not an economist today. And are you going to regret and regret and regret until you get to the grave? You will never be your best. You know, it happens like that. Somebody wants to do this, there is no admission. And then it goes in another way. Whatever your hands find to do, do it with all your might. You've not been an economist, now you have been a librarian, and then you can contribute immensely, even to that field. You can do that. But some people regret, regret, regret. Tonight, we must bury regret. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Tonight, we must not allow our past to hold us back anymore. Better things are ahead. We must focus on our limitless potential. The past can limit you, but your future is limitless. Why are you going to allow the limited past to hold down your limitless future? It's stupidity. Don't do that. Don't do that. Rather than regretting your wasted youth, his wasted youth, Abraham concentrated on making the rest of his life the very best. Rather than regret the wasted harvest of the past, concentrate on getting the best from present and future harvest. He said the harvest is ended, the summer has come, and we are not saved. Why regret? That one is gone. The harvest is not going to come back anymore. That summer is already gone. It's not going to come back anymore. It's only once. You can only look back, look forward to next year's summer. Now that you have not maximized the one today, why don't you maximize the one that is coming and do something with it? Very, very important. Rather than regretting and weeping over wasted opportunities, let us be resourceful in making the best of our new opportunities. Paul the Apostle focused on maximizing his call to the ministry rather than on the havoc he caused the church in the past. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1 and see how Paul the Apostle put it. And I want you to emulate this attitude. 1 Timothy chapter 1 in verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who had enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and is worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I'm the least, of whom I'm chief. Paul said, if you have seen sinners, you see the chief of sinners here, and God decided to capture the chief of sinners to make him the best apostle. Can you see the gap? You capture the chief of sinners in the real depth of sin, and you raise him to the height of righteousness and make him, the chiefest apostle in the church. What a glory. And in verse 16, he said, how be it, for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me, Jesus Christ, in me first, Jesus Christ might show forth all long suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to everlasting life. Paul shook up, he said, he was a blasphemer. He was a persecutor. He was very injurious, but he said, I've obtained mercy. That was in the past. Now God has committed ministry into my hand. And you see how he labored in the ministry. Paul couldn't have been able to do what he did if he was to think about the havoc he did to the church before he got saved. When you get to the point that Paul got to, you can liberate yourself. He said, I did it ignorantly in unbelief. If I knew, I wouldn't do it. Yes. So forget the past. Move on. Today is a new day. You were the chief sinner yesterday, but God has called you to be the chief apostle today. Rise up and be a chief apostle. Forget of being, you know, a chief sinner of yesterday. You've been forgiven. You have obtained mercy. Run with it. Run with the grace. That's what we need to do. Focus on your limitless potential. And that's what Paul did. He focused on the ministry rather than on the havoc that he caused the church in the past. Concentrating on our limitless potential. Just like when you concentrate on your limiting past, it has an effect on you. It holds you to failure. It holds you to mediocrity. It hinders you from going after your dream. It prevents you from pursuing your vision. It robs you of the possibility of greatness. It holds you in chains and pains. But also, when you concentrate on your limitless potential, it has a way, number one, of impacting you with passion to pursue your purpose. It makes you to be creative in your, it creates energy and enthusiasm in you to go after your dreams. When you concentrate on your limitless potential, it arouses faith within you and generates focus to pursue greatness. When you concentrate on your limitless potential, it clarifies your vision and, you know, concentrates your time for successful achievement. When you concentrate on your limitless potential, it empowers you to overcome significant obstacles. When you concentrate on your limitless potential, it imparts onto you a compelling motivation, a great drive to be your best. So it's better. How do you want to concentrate on the past when you can concentrate on the limited past, when you can concentrate on the limitless potential that you have? Concentrate on the future, what you can do, what you can be, how God can use you, where you can get to. Concentrate on that. Everywhere is open. Concentrate on that. Very, very important. And I'm praying that all of us will focus on our limitless potential in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Don't let the devil distract you into concentrating on the past. That's the devil's pastime. He wants you to see how you were rebellious in the past. He wants you to see how you didn't serve God the way you ought to serve God. That's what he wants to do. But you want to forget that. Once God has forgiven you, forget that one. Rise up. Serve God in the present. Be passionate for the gospel in the present. Do your best in the present for your family, for the kingdom of God, for the people around you. Put in your energy to develop your talent, to own your skills, to develop yourself in the present. Focus. And lastly, faith for lasting progress. Very, very important. One of the most important foundations for biblical heroes was faith. Hebrews chapter 11. Do you see that? Of all the people that were talked about in Hebrews chapter 11, they achieved a lot. Abel, he offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Noah, he built the ark that saved his family. Abraham, he obeyed God and received the promise that God promised him. Moses, he was able to be a deliverer for a whole nation. Rahab, she didn't perish with the people in Jericho. She survived to live a victorious life. If you read that, all those people in the Bible, but let me show you one thing. In verse 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good report. If you want to obtain a good report, you need to live by faith. Verse 3, through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. Even God, in creating what he created, he had to live by faith. Let there be light, and there was light. He spoke in faith, the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. God spoke them into being by faith. Verse 4, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Verse 5, by faith, Enoch was translated. Verse 7, by faith, Noah. Verse 8, by faith, Abraham. Verse 11, through faith also, Sarah. In verse 17, by faith, Abraham. Verse 21, by faith, Jacob. Verse 20, by faith, Isaac. Verse 22, by faith, Joseph. Verse 23, by faith, Moses. Verse 24, by faith, Moses. Verse 27, by faith, Moses forsook Egypt. Verse 28, through faith, he kept the Passover. Verse 29, by faith, they passed through the Red Sea. Verse 30, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. Verse 31, by faith, the harlot Rahab perished not. Verse 32, and what more shall I say? And what shall I more say? For the time will fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and of the prophets in the plural. What happened? Who through faith? What did they do through faith? They subdued kingdoms. They wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness were made strong, once valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead, raised to life again. Can you see that? All the accomplishments of the heroes of faith. It was by faith. By faith or through faith. And if also you want to get to the place of success and greatness, you need to do it by faith. Faith for lasting progress. Very, very important. One of the most important foundations for the biblical heroes was faith. The great lives of the heroes and the heroines of faith were prefaced here with the two words, by faith or through faith. That's how they accomplished what they accomplished. Unbelief and self-doubt as a way of undoing whatever progress that you make. If there's unbelief in your life, you will never make progress. It will always undo you. You will be taking wrong steps because there's not the confidence of faith to move forward. You'll be going in the wrong direction. Faith creates a bedrock for lasting progress. Faith creates a passage to the impossible. Faith will create rivers for you in the desert. Faith will make a way for you in the wilderness. Faith will make Jericho walls to tumble and crumble. Faith enables you to receive the needed wisdom for life's great challenges. You know, that's why God says, if any lacks wisdom, let him come in faith. God will give you wisdom for living, wisdom for your academics, wisdom to write winning papers, wisdom to write winning propositions in your project. Faith. God says, come in faith. He will give unto you. So faith enables us to receive the needed wisdom for life's great challenges and to discover the needed knowledge, needed know-how for getting on in life. Faith brings us the needed help and favor from God and man. Faith will bring you favor. You know, everywhere I go, I just believe that doors must open for me. It doesn't matter how difficult the place, I always get helpers. Doors will always open. What I want to get done will always get done. But I move by faith. It's not that maybe people say you are lucky. No. I'm manifesting faith. This is more than luck. Faith opens doors. Faith opens doors. Samuel told Saul, as you leave me now, you will come across a company of men going up to the mountain top to go and pray. They will give you, I don't have food, but you need food for your journey. You need drink for your journey. As you go, they will give you two loaves of bread, one for you, one for your servant, and a bottle of wine. Take it. It's God's provision for you. Then you move from there, you will meet other company of prophets. The Spirit of God will come upon you. Saul had to move by faith for those things to come to pass. Samuel is declaring it as he's receiving it from God. But if Saul does not move by faith, those things will not happen. And the Bible says, as he left Samuel, he met those people. They gave him the bread. They gave him the bottle of wine. He took it. As he moved on from there, the second thing also happened. The Spirit of God came upon him. He started prophesying among those people. You need to move in life by faith, believing that God will make a way. Some people met Jesus. They were lepers. And they wanted Jesus to heal them. Jesus told them, all right, go and show yourself to the priest. Do you know that ordinarily, that statement, nobody will do it. In Israel, when you are a leper, you are ostracized. You must not live in the community. If, whether by miracle or whatever, you healed, you cannot come to live in the community. The first thing you do is you go and show yourself to the priest that you are healed. The priest will examine you, and then the priest will give you a certificate of clean bill of health that you are now free to live in the community. These were lepers. And Jesus told them, go and show yourself to the priest. What are they going to show? But you know what the Bible says? As they went, they were healed. That's faith. You are still a leper. Jesus said, go and show yourself to the priest that you are already cleansed. The Bible says, as they went, they were healed. Faith. Faith takes action. Faith moves. Even when everything seems impossible, faith will take a risk. Even when it seems that nothing is going to work, faith for lasting progress, that's what we need. Some of us can achieve far more than we're achieving, but we are too cautious about life. We are not taking enough risks. We are not doing what we ought to do. How do you spell faith? You spell faith risk. You can walk on water, but Satan will tell you, if you step on that water, that's your last. You will drown. But faith will make you to step on water. And you walk on that water. You take the risk. And if we are going to succeed, faith for lasting progress, we need to manifest it. We need to manifest it. You know, they say, tell you that Europe is so difficult, it's difficult to make progress. And I tell people, I will make progress in Europe. And tremendous progress at that. Not only personally, even for the gospel. Say it's so difficult. Well, if you believe. Isaac said, the Lord has made room for me in this land. I will be fruitful in the land. I don't know about other people, but for me, the Lord has made room for me in this land. I will be fruitful in the land. That was Isaac's persuasion, and he was fruitful in that land. Faith for lasting progress. We need to manifest it. And God is calling us tonight and telling us, these are blueprints. The blueprint for success and greatness. Number one, once again, forgiveness, the Lord's priority. Number two, forgetting the limiting past. Number three, focusing on our limitless potential. And number four, faith for lasting progress. If we put these things together, they constitute a blueprint for success and greatness. We'll be able to celebrate accomplishments in years to come. Let's rise up and pray and tell the Lord and say, oh God, tonight, the things I've listened to, the things I've heard, I want to implement them. I want to get to the place of success, to the place of greatness. God is calling you. You can succeed, my brother. You can succeed, my sister. God can help you to be your very best. That's why he came. He can help you. He can help you. He can help you to be your very best, and he's going to do it. Blueprint for success and greatness. Blueprint for success and greatness. God can help you, my brother. God can help you, my sister. This is your opportunity. If anything is troubling you, you need to drop those hindering bodies. You need to drop those bothersome emotions. You need to drop those painful memories. They need to be gone. Somebody said this. Somebody doesn't want me to do this. Somebody did this one to me. Somebody stole my money. Somebody took my things away. Forget about those and move on. Forget about them and move on. Forget about them and move on. The future is more important than the past. The future is open for new possibilities. Put the new possibilities in the future. God is calling you to greatness, calling you to success, calling you to accomplishment, calling you to achievement. And God is saying, this is your opportunity. And by the grace of God, you will get there. By the grace of God, you will get there. God is calling you. God is calling you. God is calling you. Very, very important. Tonight is a night of victory for you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for your children that are on this platform tonight. Oh Lord, I pray that you will create a pathway to success and greatness for them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Anything in their lives that has served like bricks, anything in their life that has, from the past that has been limiting them, and putting a kind of a break on their limitless potential and future. Tonight, I pray, as they rise up, oh God, in the power of the Almighty, to do away with this, to forget this limiting past, to do away with these bothersome emotions, to do away with these painful memories, to do away with every kind of hindrance, and to pursue destiny. Oh Lord, empower them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our destiny is more important than where we are coming from. Where we are going is more important than where we are coming from. The past is gone. We cannot rewrite it, but the future is open for us to write into the future new possibilities. Oh God, help us to focus on this limitless potential in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And help us to rise in faith, believing that what God has said, I know the thoughts that I think, I mean, towards you, thoughts of good and not of evil, to give you an expected end. And we are looking for that expected end. Like the patriarchs, the Bible says they were looking for that blessed city. They were looking for that promise, and they believed it, and they were persuaded by it. And in faith, they moved, even though some of them, by the time they died, they had not received the promise. But they were they manifested faith so much looking for the promise. How much more us who are living in a generation where many of the promises have been fulfilled, that the possibility of the promises being fulfilled are very, very real, because Jesus has come and died for us, is risen, and then now all the possibilities are open for us. Oh Lord, I pray that your children will rise in faith.
Amen.
Where they need to take challenges and take opportunities and take risks, we will be able to take intelligent risks and move forward in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All the kind of hesitancy and too much caution, oh Lord, help us to lay them aside in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Help us to develop the kind of Peter's in Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.